a motion we have been open session.
So moved.
Bednarik, aye.
Lima, aye.
Catterett, aye. Okay, this meeting's being taped and will be available on SCTV at some date, which I don't know. First item on the agenda. Need a motion to consider waiving the reading of the minutes from the April 12th meeting.
Make a motion to waive the reading of the minutes from April 12th.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Lima, aye.
Catterett, aye. Okay, we're in the process of signing bills. Okay, new business. First item is annual appointment of water and sewer department personnel.
Oops. I know Jackie did give me the list.
So we have the list, right?
Yeah. I'll make a motion that we approve the list as submitted.
Second.
Lima, aye.
Bednarik, aye.
Catterett, aye. Next item is review and consider approval of the fiscal year 24 water and sewer department budgets.
There's been a steady stream of stuff coming from my office to you all, explaining where we are. I put together a summary sheet that probably will be using at next week's meeting with the selectmen, but it's the salient points of the budget of where we are, so I'd like to summarize, if I could, from that.
Please.
And then if you all have any questions, you know, we can discuss it. But anyway, total FY24 sewer water budget is $8,550,000 approximately. The total FY24 sewer water rate revenue, and this is the rate that we have been calculating that we're going to be discussing shortly, is $8,600,000. So you can see where we have budgeted enough money to cover all of our expenses, and also to include a reserve fund, which we need to do our capital projects on a yearly basis, of roughly $833,000. The sewer budget is approximately 15.9% higher than what it was last year. The explanation for that is we've had certainly some and many increases in our operating expenses and our labor costs. We knew that would come about. We've also had some capital improvements that we've had to make, and we've run all those different things by the board. So in order to be able to run the plant the way we need to at a sustained level to meet the water quality standards that we're mandated to meet, the costs increase. As part of that, there also has been an administrative cost increase, which we've discussed on a number of occasions, which we did not have before. The water budget, same reasons that it has gone up, 17.4%. I have six proposed sewer articles. The sewer articles cost on that is $770,000. I have three proposed water articles at $700,000. Those can come out of our reserve fund very comfortably. We have enough funding in there to cover that amount. Now let's just talk about the proposed water rates themselves. We have a very modest increase in the water and sewer rates at 2.5% each. And that allows us to be able to bring our budget in line with what our anticipated expenses are, and also to cover our anticipated capital improvements that we have been making in these past 2 or 3 years. So it's a very modest rate. And I would also like to indicate to you, in real terms, what that rate increase will actually mean to the town. First of all, for the typical low water user, and that user uses 15,000 gallons a year, they'll see their total annual bill increase, and I want to emphasize, total annual bill of $6.11. That's a 1.2% increase. To my mind, it's extremely manageable and reasonable. For the person that uses roughly 52,000 gallons a year, that's our average customer based on our water rate information, the average customer will see an increase, annual increase again, of $21.20. That's a 1.9% increase. For a typical high water user, and I just arbitrarily picked an amount of 500,000 gallons, I mean, it could be, you know, a high water user could be anybody, let's say 100,000 gallons or more. Even that rate increase would be $203 a year, which is 2.4% over and above what we had last year. Now, the reason why some of these numbers are working out the way they are, and I think very favorably, is because last year we took the step of incorporating a sewer user fee, and also we cut our flat fee structure by a considerable amount. And this helps the people who are on fixed incomes the most. That's who gets the maximum benefit of this budget the way it is set up now. So I think the budget is very, very reasonable. It allows us to continue our program of making capital improvements. As you all know, if we made all the capital improvements that have been recommended when we had that recent study, we're looking at, you know, north of $75 million. So this program, because we're doing it sort of at a piecemeal kind of situation and making targeted and surgical improvements to our systems, allows us to be able to do this at a still make improvements, but avoid as long as we possibly can until that day does come when we have to get a bond referendum. The other thing that I want to emphasize, which also has been a big help in the generation of this budget, is that we've been able to acquire between loans, low interest rate loans, and grants, approximately $12 to $14 million that we are able to apply to both of our capital water projects and sewer projects. It has really gone a long way. I intend to be even more proactive in chasing grants as we go along, because it does give us that ability to be able to do more projects faster. And once again, it rolls back that day when we have to go for perhaps a very large bond referendum. And I know that the town certainly has increased their bond indebtedness most recently with the schools. So I think what we have here is a very reasoned approach. I think it is an approach that takes into account the people who are on fixed income, and also allows us to move forward with making capital improvements on a slower pace. I'll grant you that, but that's how you avoid these other things. And also with the added benefit of having grants and the low interest loans, SRF loans, I think will stand us in good stead going forward. So I'm very comfortable with this budget, and just open up to any questions you all might have.
No, so just to kind of summarize, so the total annual bill includes everything. That is the total annual bill. So in this proposed budget, and then with the rate structure for a low user, the increase is 50 cents a month.
Yeah, if you do the math, it's
$6,
right.
It's like 50 cents a month. And then for someone who's considered to be a typical customer, the increase is less than $2 a month. So, I mean, I think that that certainly holds the line as much as we can, because we've seen increased costs on the water side and chemicals. We have a new labor contract that increased the cost.
Yep.
On the sewer side, the same thing with the chemicals, and then plus the sludge disposal has been a struggle, and it's expensive, so I think that the fact that we talked about what our budget's gonna increase, but what the rate increases that we need to cover our budgets and still generate retained earnings, I think that this is a approach that's beneficial to the customers, who ultimately the taxpayers in the town, so. And then, could you just, so we talk about these capital projects that we wanna do, or the articles that we're gonna have, just kinda summarize what those articles are, just so people understand that what we're looking for in those, and the fact that those are gonna be paid from our retained earnings.
Right.
They're not gonna be additional tax burden to the taxpayers.
Right, well, I'm glad you asked that, Steve, because this year, one of the, on the water side, a couple things. One of them is our main water pumping station on Brook Street. That station is in dire need of improvement. Anybody has been by there, I'll be happy to take anybody for a tour to see exactly how that is. But let me explain the importance of that pumping station. If that station is out of commission, we can't draw water from the Segregated, which means we can't fill our reservoir. That is a key component. The pumps are old. I'm looking into the possibility, if the housings and whatnot are good, we can rehabilitate them. Maybe the motors, I've had Wright Pierce do a study, so I know exactly, you know, the scope of work that needs to be done. There's improvements to the building that need to be made, the roof leaks, you know, small minor HVAC stuff, just so it won't continue to deteriorate and end up in a situation where it's not usable anymore. Another project, and I'm just doing this off the top of my head, but
yeah.
As far as the water side is concerned, we want to begin to renovate and modernize our clarifiers. Those are our main treatment components. We have three of them, and they've been in effect for quite a while, and luckily they will continue to be part of our treatment process for a long time to come. Future improvements to the plant will include polishing that effluent even more as the standards increase that our water quality has to meet, but we can always keep that as our backbone. So those are in starting to show their age. We want to replace the media, we want to replace the internal piping, we also want to clean up and repaint and fix up any damage that we're starting to see coming through. If you next time you buy, you'll notice that the base flange at most of the concrete, that's starting to delaminate a little bit. We want to you know, rectify all that. The upshot of the whole thing is, I'd like to do one of those a year, because right. They're about $400,000. That's the number that we're getting now. So this budget would include some money for that. Also, Harry is getting a new sludge pumping station. And we talked about the liquid sludge and how critical that's gonna be going forward. There's other work. I probably should just go ahead and get my, can I just go and get my?
Yeah, that's fine, yeah.
Yeah, just give me a minute.
No, just so people know, because I mean, you know, you talk about, okay, we're gonna have, you know, 9 articles and, you know, and we're gonna spend almost $1.5 million. Well, what is that? What are we doing with that? We're trying to make improvements to a system that's aged and that needs some improvements. So we're trying to use our retained earnings to do that as much as we can.
Someone's gonna have a lot of reading to do.
That's a special meeting, Steve.
Make sure you get your glasses on. Okay, replace chlorination, dechlorination controls. That's at the wastewater treatment plant. So, you know, that's something that's gotta be done. The other one is, let's see. Replace the pump controller at Foley, which is one of our main pumping stations. Rebuild and replace sewage pumps at Pilot Drive and Foley Avenue pumping stations. Replace HVAC system at the operations building at the wastewater treatment plant. You know, that some of that stuff is just It just needs to be...
It's original from the 1970s.
Yeah, exactly.
It's old, it needs to be replaced. It's outlived its service life.
And finally, the new sludge pumping station. Water articles, I just mentioned the one about upgrading the raw water pumping station and upgrades and modifications to the filter clarifiers. And, let's see, final one here is, oh yes. And hot and cold, you know that project is ongoing, we need an easement, so that'll be a special article. Fortunately, that doesn't cost us anything. And then also there's a special article for Harry's pumping stations to have the town sign off on a SRF loan for $4.7 million. So that's what we had hoped to be able to use some grant money for, but so far, we haven't been successful. But there's a lot of good projects. This is about $1.5 million that we're spending. But that's the kind of doable approach I think we can feed in, especially on the water side, to get us the improvements that we need and try to resist, you know, a large bond referendum.
Good, that's a good summary. Good. Anybody else have any questions? Okay, so we're gonna go to the select next Wednesday, correct? So we need to take a vote to approve this budget.
Motion to approve the fiscal year 2024 budget for Somerset Water and Somerset Sewer Departments.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Lee Marai.
Catterett, aye. No, Paul, this is a good job of this.
Thank you very much.
Very good job.
And look, I have to say, you know, a lot of this relates to my discussions and input from the board. Past members and also new members, you know, everybody's been all working together and, you know, there is a need and I just really appreciate so much the support from the board, because obviously without this, I can't go in all good conscience, you know, next week, you know, to meet if I know that you guys aren't 100% behind us. So I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Okay, next item. Consider the appointment of Nicholas Vieira of 189 Washington Avenue, Somerset, Mass. As maintenance supervisor at the Water Pollution Control Department.
Okay, I sent you all his qualifications for the project. I was very impressed with this gentleman, and Harry, you can speak up. But we interviewed him, and actually on a couple of occasions, he I think is going to be the right kind of candidate, and I think it's an ideal position for him to fill at the wastewater treatment plant as basically being Harry's right-hand man. Some of his attributes, he is very well-versed and always having to, because of his profession, having to upgrade his schooling. He's not afraid of testing. He's not afraid of advancing and getting other licenses. Harry and I spoke to him. We said that we want him to, you know, make sure that he pursues his grade 4 license. I think he's got 2 years of doing that, Harry.
Yes. The current position to the job description requires him to get an operator's license.
Right.
He's a good choice for that.
Good.
He's very fit. And what I mean by that is, you know, he's always been an active guy. Well, you can see from his resume what his job is. And we asked him, is there anything at the treatment plant that you might be a little squeamish about? He said, are you kidding? He said, I've seen, sometimes we walk into places where there's been a body, you know, dead, you know, there for several days. So there's nothing we have at the treatment plant that is gonna, you know, make an EMT blush, let's put it that way.
Right.
I took him to gave him a tour of the plant. We spent a good 3 hours at least at the treatment plant, and also to a pump station, and you know, so he was very interested in tour, went very well with
Did you bring him down the wet well?
I did not bring him down to the wet well, but I did.
We wanted that
I did show him,
yeah, really.
I did show him a wet well because of the confined space entry stuff. So I think, you know, and the same thing with, you know, his background of his previous employment and stuff like that, so he was...
Might change his mind about being squeamish once he gets down there.
No, he was good. And, yeah, took him, you know, through sludge dewatering, we were composting, so he was quite...
That's the easy part down there.
He saw that, yeah.
It's the grease islands again, yeah.
So basically, we would be starting in at M3, step six. I have the letter written for submission pending approval by this board of this candidate.
So he has to do his CORI check and his physical yet?
Correct.
Okay, so that'll be included in the motion?
That's subject to that, yes.
Yeah, it'll be subject to him passing.
Right.
Yes.
Any questions?
Joe, you want to make a motion to...
Absolutely, make a motion to appoint Nicholas Vieira of 189 Washington Ave, Somerset, Mass., 02726. Pending that his background check and his physical come out. Okay.
And the grade and step, does that have to be approved by the town administrator?
Correct.
Or is that...
We have the letter. Harry and I have been speaking about it relative to what other folks, this is a bylaw position,
right,
relative to what other folks are making there, so it should be pretty much cut and dry. And obviously, we need to get somebody in,
right,
to take,
yep,
care of Chris Leopas's position. And I'm elated the fact that I think he's a quality candidate.
Good. I'll second that.
Okay, roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Lemur, aye.
Cataret, aye.
So that means now you only have four vacant positions at wastewater.
Well, I think we're going to be bringing another person very shortly. So.
Okay, on to the reports. Who wants to go first?
Okay. Harry, why don't you go ahead and talk to us?
Excellent job.
I do what I can. I practice.
You want me to start out with the current flow at the wastewater treatment plant,
yep,
is 2.8 million gallons.
It's not too bad.
It's unusual. It's a lot lower than the previous calendar year in April that I was looking at. The other thing is that we've only had 0.72 inches of rain. So
very dry month.
Very
really
extremely dry for us, and like I say, we're still at 2.8 million. Last year, at this for the month of April, we averaged 3.8 million. Okay, and when I look at the precip last year was a relatively dry month, also for April of 2.7 inches of rain. So it wasn't a very wet month for us. So flows have been dropping. So far we've had a max of, and it was the first day in April, of 3.9. So we've dropped a million gallons since April 1st in two week period. So kind of fortunate with that, with which Chairman was mentioning earlier with my Synagro, which is a company that hauls, they take our liquid sludge in 9,000 gallon tankers, and that's been very challenging at the wastewater treatment plant. Last week, I had one load go out on Monday. I did not hear from them all week of challenges of them being overloaded at their wound socket plant that takes our material. I ended up getting two loads out on a Saturday. When it comes to Saturdays, I got to schedule employees to come in to spend time with that. Mentioned earlier about one of the articles of sludge pumping. We are using a portable pump outside. We had a solenoid on the starter fail, so it was challenging. I had delays of loading up the second truck on Saturday. We spent over an hour and a half of changing over pumps, trying to get the other portable pump to work, and so that was challenging on Saturday. So I did get two loads out, but that was very insignificant. Typically, when I look at concentrations of my biological process, I typically run summertime coming out of winter, we're typically $3,000, $3,500 for mixed liquors. Currently, I'm at 7,500 milligrams per liter of concentration, which is, I've never been that high in the 30-some years that I've worked there. So I'm holding a lot of solids in the system, and it's still a struggle of disposing of material. I don't know if I'll get another load out until the weekend again. So I've been in contact with Cinegrill. They're looking at other disposal sites. We're sending lab data to them to see if they can leave us with something. But I got a lot of material that's backlogged into the treatment plant. The good news is that on my NIPTES permit, which is my discharge permit out to the Taunton River, I had zero violations for the month of March. And so far, April, I'm still good. But clarifier blankets, same thing. I'm carrying blankets of 6 to 8 feet in the final clarifiers. I'd love to be down to 2 feet.
So you're not in any danger of busting anything in there, are you, having in the clarifiers?
things are...
Please, we just had them rebuilt.
Yeah, we had them rebuilt. So Cinegrill's been my... solids handling's been a major issue of getting the material out. We're trying to... We did a little bit of compost. I got a lot of material stored in there, and hopefully things change down there soon. I still think it's going to be a struggle for a while to take in the most critical plants. And, you know, every time I talk to them, it's like, I had two loads go out on a Monday, and we don't have a lot of storage capacity in our sludge holding tanks. That's the other thing. We're a small plant. Once I thicken up the solids, I have very little room. So when they're taking out of one well, which is 12,000 gallons capacity, they're taking 9,000. So it takes me to fill that sludge well up again and process the material. So those are the challenges I've been having. So I had two truckloads go out on Monday, so I'm spending time there trying to remove the solids over the 3-day weekend and stuff. So we were able to do that. But they took two loads out on Monday, Patriots Day, the holiday. The truck driver spent 9 hours waiting to unload at the Woonsocket really facility. Wow. So the truck, you know, the trucking company is a contract company to sit, you know, for Cinegrill and stuff like that. So for them to spend 9 hours waiting just to unload a tanker truck. And so those are the horror stories we're hearing through Cinegrill. Project status.
We need to, so I mean, long term, this keeps going on. We don't have any storage capacity, right? We need to rent storage capacity?
I do have some emergency storage. I really don't want to use it because it's outside tanks. Older generation is going to be a huge problem, Steve.
Well, when we're monitoring it, we want to see what the situation is with Cinegrill going forward.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the state, we say it every week, but every 2 weeks, the state puts us in the situation because of where else can you get rid of solids?
How long is that pipe that goes out the breaking point that we don't know?
How long?
The gray water pipe.
How long is that?
It's all the way from the plant right up to the entrance.
If anything, we'll take it up to Falmouth.
I mean, the only blessing I have is that the precip is not.
Right.
If I'd gone through a typical spring, the flows would be tremendously, and I'd be storing the material in other locations. Yeah.
Right.
It would be in, like I said, been very fortunate with the amount of rain that we've gotten and stuff like that, and the issues that we have with sludge disposal. It's been huge.
How many loads should we be taking out a week?
Typically, under normal conditions, I do one per day. A lot of times in the summertime, there'll be like 6 loads per week.
Right.
But I'm lucky if I get 3.
Yeah.
Right now, and I've been so far behind since the first of the year. This has been going on between mechanical issues. Now they're having, you know, Cinegrill operates the incinerator. When the Holland liquid sludge did dewater and not sludge, that dewatered sludge, that filtrate or that substrate goes to the Woonsocket facility. That's, those are some of the issues that I think it's, they only can take so much liquid sludge.
Okay.
I think that's been the issue.
So we couldn't, we don't have a contract with them anymore for the dried materials?
No, they would not allow us to do that, Bob. They came to us and they said.
Yeah.
Bob, we were having problems with meat and dryness of the material with our old belt filter presses and stuff like that.
Yeah, I remember that from years ago.
So that was an issue of driving it towards liquid and stuff like that.
So.
Bob, believe it or not, that's been brought up, possibly as an alternative, but.
The costs are extremely prohibitive to do that.
The centrifuges are big money.
Well, not only that, but you know where we are with the plant in terms of planning.
Yeah.
We don't want to go down that road and spend a ton of money only to find out it does not. So we're going to have to limp along as best we can until.
But are we, I mean, so we're always going to need solids removal, no matter what.
No matter what.
But it's a function of where we're in this interim gray area here, that if we do something on an emergency basis, we overreact, we could spend, and I mean a ton of money, and then, now, if we spend that ton of money, we still have to make sure that we still dewater to the dryness that they want.
Right.
So suppose we do all that, we swing and miss.
Yeah, right.
Now what do we do? Now we're down the road with this one.
Right.
To me, they're going to take the liquid sludge, we'll have to ride the train with them, as long, you know.
Yeah.
And.
Do we have any other places we can go in a case of emergency right now?
No. Our backup is compost, and the other problem we got is we're a small plant. We operate one shift. You know, is there, if you slow the equipment down, could you increase that percentage of cake? Yes, you could. You know, the problem is that we, you know, when we're operating with our belt filter presses, we had to move material out and get it out of there, but we were only a one-shift operation. If you extended your operation to a 24-hour shift or a two-shift operation, you could get a drier material with the existing equipment you've got.
And that's assuming the existing equipment, which is aged. Yeah.
Right, which is.
Is up to the task, because.
Yeah, we used to have a problem when I was here before.
Yeah,
that
so
was a problem
absolutely.
Then.
So, you know, so there's certain things that, you know, how big of a band-aid do you want to put on this thing? But at the same point, you got to stay in compliant with your material too. So they have their struggles, and you know, hopefully they get them resolved as best they can. But yeah, so I just sent some lab data to them. They're looking at possibly disposing, you know, material in Cranston and stuff like that. So,
okay.
So there's
under their contract.
Under their contract.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so
that's what's
key.
Right.
You know, this can't be on us, it's gotta be.
Right.
And just remember, we're in the second year of the contract right now. So it was a 3-year contract that was signed with them. So in the future, we gotta look at that also, of, you know, what's gonna happen in that third year.
Problem is, there's not really a lot of alternatives.
Who do you turn to?
Them and Cranston.
That's a huge problem. So at some point, it would seem to me that the state's going to have to open some stuff up to us, because we're not the only facility having that problem.
No.
We're not.
No.
So if we're being impacted, other facilities are being impacted.
Correct.
So they must be hearing it from everybody. You know, what can we do about this? So I think at some point they'll realize what the situation is and have to cut us some slack some way, somehow.
Yeah, it's not only sewage, it's water sludge too, right? Same boat.
Same thing.
It's
solid waste, everything.
Yeah.
It's a huge problem. Paul mentioned earlier about the, we got the, Wright Pierce is our consultant engineer. We just got the plans for the liquid sludge pumps, trying to get them from being outside to inside the building. We just received a 90% design drawing and specifications for that, so
good.
Got them in this week. Beta Engineering, works with Stormwater and MS4 permitting. They're gonna do a plant inspection either this Friday or early next week.
That's gonna be...
Okay, and...
That goes to what you said.
Yeah, we were talking about them today.
And so that's what I have for my report for today.
Thank you, Harry.
You're welcome.
Sorry to steal your thunder, I didn't mean to.
You normally do.
I try not to. Well, you can always go first if you want.
Water level, I'm sorry, our plant flow, just once again to reinforce our infiltration problem, 1.57 MGD average. Harry, what did you say, 2.8?
2.8 to kind of flow.
So we're closer with...
Yeah.
We're usually...
We're only double, that's not bad.
Exactly. Our THM project is finally getting underway in a bigger way. Wright Pierce notified us that the water storage tank draining will need to commence the week of April 24th, so that'll be a big deal. Let's see. Our engineering is completing the final stages of the phase one levy improvements. It's anticipated this project will be out to bid shortly, so we'll have another project under construction. Let's see. We've received a revised lead and copper sampling schedule from DEP. We are scheduled for 30 sample sites.
Correct.
Once a year for the next 3 years. This is a reduction of 120
Correct.
Sites for standard monitoring. Also, our lead pipe, lead service analysis is getting underway shortly. I was talking to Wright Pierce about that today. The $300,000 grant relative to the fire hydrant replacement is finally, it's we don't have the big check yet, but we have the paperwork that's leading toward that, so we can put that, we're pretty much in the bank. Coastal Construction completed 600 linear feet of water main removal and replacement on Parsons Lane. This included 1950-06 inch cast iron pipe and some asbestos cement piping. All that was removed. We had to, of course, meet the appropriate rules and regulations for proper disposal, but that went up very, very, very quickly and no issues at all. So that's all done. And when we do these projects, what we're trying to do now is we're coordinating so that the services get replaced from the main to the street, new hydrant gets put in, and then we call the highway department and they come in and pave it. So it's a tribute.
They did a good job, because that's near my house.
Yeah.
They did a good job on that work.
That was coastal.
That thing was always buttoned up nice at the end of the night.
Yep.
They protected that temporary piping with the services. They did a good job on that.
Yep. Yeah. We also have a contract electrician, he did some work at the plant, because we're looking at all the panels to make sure that, to verify their condition and making, once again, these are all minor improvements, but if you let those go, they can turn into major problems. So he's worked at the plant. He's also done some work at the raw water pumping station.
Have you guys ever thought of having like one of the companies come in and do the thermal imaging, take a look at the panels in here because of the age?
No, we haven't done that, Joe. But you know what? I'm going to check with Jimmy and see what.
There's only a couple of them around here to do it.
We work
with infrared and stuff.
Infrared's
like that.
Really good. There's American
testing.
American testing is pretty good. Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, that's up for you guys to figure out who you want to
yeah.
go with.
Most of the time, we just look, you know, like generate transfer switches and stuff like that. Some of the bigger stuff.
You might want to do like the MVPs and stuff.
Yeah.
Just to, they're getting up there in age, you know.
Yeah.
There's a lot
yeah.
of times, and you don't know, you're in those environments that are, they're nasty, they're hot, you don't know where the heat's coming from, and sometimes, you know, you could have a panel going into meltdown just from one loose connection.
Right. Well, that's what it is going in there, tightening them up to make sure that
no cool
tight and stuff, but usually, you know, sometimes you see that tarnish color and stuff. And
not always anymore, you know?
No, Joe.
We work with the excavation contractor in the town to complete to completely replace a 2-inch service for the Pottersville Little Red Schoolhouse. We did that on Saturday, 4:15. We finally replaced a vintage water meter. This was 1940-0 piping and suspected to have goosenecks. Lead goosenecks, I should say. So that's the water report. Relative to the superintendent's report, a lot of this stuff we've already covered. I'll just summarize some of the important points that I may have missed. Well, we had the budget discussion, so that's all set. Oh, I don't know if you all noticed the new little 100% electric vehicle that we have outside.
Is that out there?
Nobody's going to steal
it.
Yeah, that's got the wind up kit. I figured nobody's going to steal the thing. So. But anyway, we just got that. And that replaces a full size pickup truck for Chris Wickman. And yes, he will fit in it. I made sure. And more importantly, our resupply station, our connection, 100% works. We've had it running. So.
Oh, really?
We can recharge it. So that replaces, you know, that particular truck. And Chris does not do a lot of driving, and he does not do much having to carry material in the back. So we have an excess vehicle. What we're going to do is we're going to get rid of the Colorado. That's going, I think, to the recreation department. That's the plan at this point. And Chris's truck will be the overflow truck. So we're working in that direction. So, and by the way, that truck was funded from the proceeds that we had left over from the solar project.
Okay.
So that has not cost us an additional amount of money for that vehicle.
Yeah, I mean, just so people know, I teach the EVITP program to Southeast New England, which is the electrical infrastructure program. And the electric cars have, nationwide, somewhere between like a 50 to 60% cost savings compared to gasoline right now. So this is going to be a huge savings for the department moving forward.
I could see in the right circumstances, you know, they can work. Received notification. We did get, I might have covered this last week, but the SRF loan application for $4.78 million. We have that. Bobby, at the last meeting, you asked about VADAR. Let me just give you a brief scenario of where we stand with that. All of our staff who needs to work on that and will be working on that has received the training. So far, we've been working very well along with Town Hall and meeting their expectations as to how we plan going forward to be able to work together so that we're not duplicating effort. There's still more to come. There's a whole accounting aspect of this that as time goes on, we will be incorporating as Town Hall requires us to get that far down the road with it. So,
okay.
If you need any more on that, you know, you guys feel free to contact Jackie. So.
Sure.
And unfortunately, one of the grants that we had applied for, which was not in the $12 million that I mentioned, but that was the one a couple of weeks ago. We had to hurry up. We had like 3 days to respond to it, which we did. We got it out. And unfortunately, we didn't get that one, but I'm assured by Wright Pierce and their folks who handle our grant writing and also doing a lot of beating of the bushes for us that, you know, more grants are on the way. So we're just going to be like vacuum cleaners and get as much as we can for the town. That's all I have.
No, we've worked hard at that. I mean, you've done a real good job of that.
Well, once again, really support yeah. from the board. I mean, you know, because I bring stuff, you guys evaluate it. I get an answer right away, I'm out to get it. So I appreciate your support very much.
Good. Thank you. Next thing is a preliminary report prepared and received from Paul Healy, a 10-year review of water quality data from Somerset Water Department.
I believe you all have received a package of information. It comprises two items. One is actually Paul's report, and we indicated Wright Pierce was going to do a complete review of it. We just got the Wright Pierce report in recently. I don't know if you all have had a chance to study this, and if you want to, you know, take any action on it tonight, or I think Mr. Healy is understanding that if another week is required, we can discuss it at a fuller time next week if that's the decision of the board.
Have you seen the comments?
No, you have.
No.
Maybe just, I mean, you know, it's the second week you're taking time to be here. If you just could give us a summary of what you did and how you did it, and then maybe, you know, we have the report, then we could give you the comments that we got from Wright Pierce, and then if we need to discuss those comments, and our next meeting, we can certainly do that. So if you want to do that today, that'd be great.
So my prior motivation for this was to understand whether there's any possibility of the Brayton Point work contaminating our water supply. And so in that process, we recognize there's a distance, about 5 miles at least, of that. I was more interested in whether there was aquifers connecting Brayton Point down the, up to here. And I checked with the U.S. Geological Service, there's a reference there who I talked with. And they said that there was no indication that there was an aquifer. Therefore, all we have is our water source is the reservoir, which collects water from the Segregated as well as rainwater that comes in or comes through that. So it's really surface water.
Yeah,
right. And then the other source has been, over the past 10 years, the Dighton number 2 well, and I know that that was re-drilled and things like that. So that has its own little uniqueness of radioactivity and other things that we at least are aware that could occur, that are naturally occurring and things like that. And so I then, as a second motivation, wanted to understand the water coming into the plant and as it's leaving the plant. And I'm stopping there because I'm not saying anything about the information from the plant to the people's locations as to the drinking water or whatever they use the water for, with the exception of where there are locations that are reported draws of water at different sites throughout the town. And that data is in that report, or at least in the data I got. There's some missing stuff, and I just pointed that out. And,
sure.
Some of it was only collected for certain years because of certain mandates and, by the state, and I believe just by the state. I don't know, maybe because of the feds as well.
Yeah.
And so I just put that together as different things. I had questions that I felt were appropriate to ask. I hope I've captured all that information correctly, and that's why I made it a preliminary report to see if there's something I was missing so that the department here could at least add to it, and we have a fuller report. And the intent was to get this group to look at that report as well as the consultant's report. I would hope that at some point I get to look at the consultant's report and be able to match that see if
absolutely.
I have any additional information that I might want to ask of this group. And then once it's sort of blessed and we find issues, disclosure information to the public, then that should obviously go up to the Board of Health and they should be able to do that, okay?
Yeah, no, I mean, you obviously put a lot of work into this and we appreciate the effort that you put in to do this. I mean, I've read the report. The comments from our consultant, those are public, that's a public document.
Yep.
So you're certainly willing to have a copy of those comments and you can look at that.
So what I was hoping to do is to get the consultant's report and make an addendum plan. I'm not going to change my original report.
Right.
But if I had anything else that I had questioned or had a difference of opinion on, I wanted to have a chance to address that. Okay?
And that's the way we're going to proceed. I just wanted this board to be
I'm good with that.
Comfortable with that.
Yeah, so we'll get you a copy of the comments.
I'll email it to you.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah, and then that way you can take a look at that. You can put an addendum to the report.
Yeah.
Then obviously we'll have our consultant look at the addendum just the same way they looked at the report. And then we can, once we go through that process, maybe you can come back after that process. So maybe, I don't know, a month and a half or something like that probably.
Yeah.
We're going to go to one meeting a month in beginning in May. We're going to vote on that. But we did that last year. So that when we do that, we can put you on an agenda and then we can have time to discuss the addendum and the entire report. Now, if you've got questions of us or we have questions of you, that we can ask that. But no, I think it was helpful to give us a summary of what you did. We have the document, but it's a lot to look at. So,
Steve, I agree the report's very well done. Paul has been very good to deal with. At least so far, Paul, with no adversarial position one way or the other.
Yep.
It's been a good transfer of information. We appreciate what he's done, and we'll continue to work with him.
Right.
And just to say, Tim is here for the health agent, and I want that stuff to go up to them. They can decide what they need to do, if anything.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, and as you know, we are highly regulated on the water side by DEP. So, you know, it's not just a matter of dealing with the town board of health, it's really with DEP. We really got to satisfy DEP. That's who we really got to work with. And the whole TTHM project is an outgrowth to us trying to come to compliance with the DEP requirements, so. Good, so thank you.
Yep.
Continues to another date?
So they're going to give me the comments and I'm going to go through them, so yes.
Okay, so we're not, there's no need to continue at this point until.
All right, okay.
I mean, I think we could tentatively say the June meeting, that'll give us a couple months.
I think, and I agree, Steve, I mean, if we, Paul, if you want to leave that as an option.
Let's leave that on as it is, yeah, June is fine. I'm going to work on the fluoridation issue is next.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
When we set that June date, we'll just.
We'll let Paul know. Yeah, okay, good.
So, Board, just one other thing is I know that there's an agenda item on fluoridation coming up at the town hall. My hope was in the next week, if I get the information from you on fluoridation that I requested, that I can write something and get it to this group as well, okay? But there's a time constraint on that since it's May 15th, I think.
I think, Paul, did I send that, because I know we generated some information you wanted to know. Pardon me, how much material.
That was verbally, I didn't have it in writing.
Okay, I'll get that to you until that should be all set.
And there's a comment on that issue in the comment letter from. Okay, good.
I put it to myself, okay, I got to be the second.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
And next thing, consider approval of a new drain layer license application for Reposo Company Landscape and Construction LLC of 173 Stafford Road, Fall River, Mass. That's Mr. Lemus.
I have the application here. It appears that Henry has signed it and given his blessing.
I have. He said he's a new drain layer, and I gave him a test on there. He did very well on the tests and stuff like that. So everything's in the water. The only thing I asked was an update on his insurance with the XCU. It's not. I don't believe it's presently on that one. So. That's the only thing, but everything else is in line, so there shouldn't be a problem with it.
That's a good question. Do we get a copy of the insurance? Are we named as insured on that? On the insurance certificate?
This one here says we're the certificate holder also.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah,
so, okay.
Yeah.
But you're saying that you don't believe his insurance is.
He's got to get the XCU. He didn't have a problem with that.
Okay.
So that's the only thing that I would uphold on that, and that's always a thing of. I do have new drain layers of them with the XCU, which is the underground.
So do you want to table this until the next meeting?
He doesn't have a job coming up. It's, like I say, if you want to prove it's subject to that at this point and hold up any permits that would be issued.
I'll go along with that.
Yeah. So until he comes up with that, he's still got to get the bond, I believe, on that one also.
Okay.
There's a bond requirement of $20,000. I tell them not to do it until the board approves of being the licensed drain layer. So
he'll be conditionally approved.
Yes.
On meeting those two.
Yep.
Items. I'll make that motion.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik aye.
Lima aye.
Catterett aye. Okay, next thing, consider approval of a new drain layer. License application for JV Corporation, P.O. Box 1155 Westboro, Mass.
That's a general contractor for the junior high school. Bob.
He didn't sign the application.
No, I know that.
What's the board's pleasure? Since he hasn't signed the application, should we table that until the next meeting?
Yeah, I would say table. I mean,
yeah, that's fine.
He doesn't have to make this connection very shortly, right?
I don't believe so.
Okay. So we will hold off on his and we'll put him on the next agenda.
Good. Any other topics not reasonably anticipated?
Well, I hated to barge in on you, but.
Yes, Mr. Fisher.
selectmen's meeting, I have the road approval coming up, and according what I hear, Paul didn't receive any as-bills on the road, and I don't know why. All I know is if I don't...
You know what I got? I sent one of the guys down to pick it up, as I got a call from Paul on Friday. I got one little drawing that showed, it said as-built on it, but it was just the road. Didn't show utilities, didn't show anything.
Every department got one. Did you get one, Harry?
I did not get one. I did not get one, Chuck. No.
If I don't get approval this time for this meeting, I gotta wait till December.
Well, we haven't had a chance to review it, Chucky. I mean, I don't know what else to tell you. You know, I mean, I just can't go as a professional and just, you know, approve stuff without reviewing it. Now, I understand you have a time crunch, but, you know, that's... I can't see how that relates.
I don't know why, but somebody dropped the ball.
Well, I'm just, you know, he didn't get it, I didn't get it, so... In fact, I just got, you know, this handed to me by Tim. At the door.
So is that going on for tonight's meeting?
That's on for tonight's meeting. We haven't had a chance to review it.
What's it for?
It's for Sunshine...
Street acceptance, right?
Yeah.
Who was supposed to distribute?
Please?
Who was supposed to distribute the...
I give them to the planning board. You give them to the secretary, and the secretary's supposed to distribute them. But I just found this out now at 4 o'clock.
May what? May 11th?
I don't know if they set the town meeting at this point.
May 11th.
Is that the date? Okay.
So is it possible to get those to the engineers and have, try to put a... I don't know how you do it anymore.
Bobby, I could get this done, you know, by noontime tomorrow. I mean, he's got to review it, Chris has got to review it.
Yeah.
And I have to bless it. I mean, that's...
So it doesn't go to our engineering firm? No?
No, not...
Okay. They've already approved it.
Yeah. No, no, I got... Wow. You know, our guys have even seen... Did you witness the sewer line going in here? Did your guys see that?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was back, away.
We've seen everything go in, it's just that by right, there's supposed to be a set of as-bills.
Right.
I have nothing to look at.
There's copies, there's 8 copies, and there's Mylars, and everything was submitted to the town. Proline Engineering did the work, and he's going to the meeting, but... It's a nightmare for me. It's been going on 3 years for a 350-foot road.
Well, I think maybe, I mean, if I were in your shoes, I would just relay to them that the engineers will be happy to review it. We haven't had an opportunity to, but we have seen, which I think is critical, we have seen the pipe going in. So we know it's in the ground. It's just it doesn't show on a plan that somebody stamps.
No, have an inspection.
You have all that stuff, but you know what? I got to say that you know, somewhere along the line, those plans are supposed to be submitted if you want to get stuff reviewed. I know you know this. I know you know this.
This was done 4 weeks ago.
I get it, but you know what are we supposed to do?
So they won't. You believe that they're going to?
I don't know.
Can you ask that they hold, still keep it on the warrant, and then pending an approval by Paul at the town meeting?
That's why.
I mean, he can get up and...
Yeah, we can certainly do that.
I can't, I mean, I'll do my best to get it up.
Are you going to?
I'm not going to the meeting, no.
No, he's going to the meeting.
So?
I mean, I guess.
He's your engineer. I mean, he's got to advocate for you.
I mean, he sent everything over to them.
Yeah, well, I wish I could help you, but like I said, we went over yesterday, we picked it up. I got a 8.5 by 11 drawing that said as-built. I looked at it with Chris, I said, I can't do anything with this.
Yeah.
It's not...
Yeah, usually we'd get the Mylars, the as-built, everything from the planning board, and that would come forward to here, and we would put them in the file.
Yeah.
I think the best bet is maybe... You know, have the selectman's office contact Paul tomorrow and see where it is in the process so that it's installed. That's the only thing that's holding it up.
I mean, I think Mr. Fisher knows that we work with you every possible way that we can. And I feel that the Board of Selectmen will certainly cut you some slack if you explain to them that, look, this is what happened, and just reinforce to them that we did witness the pipes going in, we just don't have the, in accordance with the script that's written for these projects, the actual as-built plans in hand. That's what we're supposed to get, so.
Okay. We'll see what happens. Thank you.
Yeah.
It isn't the first one, right? It's not the first one. That's happened numerous times over the years.
You know, and first of all, we get a call from Paula, or an email on Friday. So first thing I do is, where's the plans? Mm. I have them here. Said, Chris, Tom, all we got was that one document that showed the roadway layout, but nothing else. I'm interested in utilities. That's all I care about, is right, making sure that, you know, yeah, the water and the sewer are there. I mean, I'm not the designer. Highway will have to review it to make sure that everything got built, the road's crowned, everything's paved the way they want it. That's right. That's up to them.
Did they get a set of plans?
I don't know.
Yeah,
we have all good intentions as a town, but
yeah,
we have a terrible way of communicating department to department, and it really shows here.
Okay. Yeah, usually what's happened in the past is we've always got them from the planning board.
Yep.
Prior to that town meeting vote,
right,
we've made sure everything
that's
was in.
That's typically how it goes.
Right.
That's been my experience when I'm
right
on his side of the table, right? That's
right,
his,
yeah, exactly,
leader.
Yeah. Yeah.
The selectmen, I believe, if they wish, they can look at the tape. We'll try to do as much as you can for them, right? Before the town meeting.
100%. I mean,
yeah,
we're not, they keep it on
the warrant.
Yeah.
Right.
Paul can always get up and say he's reviewed everything
right
and it's forward.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, you simply do that at town meeting and just say it's been reviewed and approved.
It's been done in the past.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I don't see an issue with that.
Yeah, good.
Yeah. But, I mean, that's, if you don't have the plans.
Yeah. And
also,
it's very unfortunate. I mean, you don't want these kind of situations to happen.
Yeah. But I think the Board of Selectmen would cut him some slack. I can't see why not. I mean, it's not that we haven't.
I mean, you can still keep it on the warrant, and if there's a problem, then you pull it that night of the meeting.
Right. Postpone the vote. That's all.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Just him.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Bednarik aye.
Lemur aye.
Catterett aye.